Welcome to Bible Baptist Church. If you could turn it, please stand and turn in your hymnals to 252. We're going to sing Higher Ground. 252, Higher Ground. If you could please stand. We're going to sing all four verses of this good song of Higher Ground. On the first. I'm pressing on the upward way. New heights I'm gaining every day. Still praying as I onward bound. And let me stand by faith on heaven's table land, a higher plane that I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. If you're just joining with us, it's 252 Higher Ground on the second. My heart has no desire to stay where doubts arise and fears dismay. Though some may dwell where these abound, my prayer, my aim is higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's table land, a higher plane that I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. If you're just joining with us, it's 252 Higher Ground. And we're on the third verse of 252, Higher Ground, on the third.
I want to live above the world, though Satan's darts at me are hurled. For faith has caught the joyful sound, the song of saints on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's table land, a higher plane that I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground.
On the fourth,
I want to scale the utmost height and catch a gleam of glory bright. But still I'll pray till heaven I'm found. Lord, lead me on to higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's table land, a higher plane that I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground.
Amen. Good evening, everyone. Welcome back to Bible Baptist Church for our Wednesday evening services. It's good to see y'all can make it. We'll go ahead and start our services off with the word of prayer. And I want to call on my brother Nathan. Yeah. Ask the Lord to bless our services.
Let us pray. Lord, we want to thank you so much. Once again, tonight to worship you, Lord God. We ask you to open up our heart and our mind that we may take in that what it is you're trying to teach us here today so we can grow more in you, Lord God. Thank you so much that you give us a pastor that loves us and teaches us your word, Lord God, that's always praying for us and going to you about us, Lord God. We thank you and praise you for all that you've given us and speak to our pastor tonight. And we ask these things in Jesus Christ's name. Amen.
Amen. And thank you and be seated. And as you're being seated, I've got some bad news for you. The bad news is that time changes this Sunday. So some like it, some don't like it. But that falls upon us this Sunday. So whether you like it or not, I think you're going to have to change your clock and follow the new time. So otherwise, you'll be missing lots of events and things. So, but time changes this Sunday, just to let you know, give you a little heads up on that. And at the church, we'll follow the time change. So some churches, they still assemble with the old time. And then after church, they change their clocks and go with the new time because they don't want to throw everybody off. And it's really common in Fiji. They just stay with the old time until the end of the service. But and I've heard of it here too, but we're just going to follow the time. Amen? So some will be late, some will be early by an hour. And so, falls back. In the spring, it springs forward, falls back. So, you get another hour sleep, right? Amen. Or am I backwards on that?
Yes.
Yeah, good. So you can stay up all night and watch movies. we have a revival coming up also. We got those flyers in the back there. If you want to take some flyers home and give them some friends and family who you believe might come, they can have that and keep it so they have the dates that's going on. There'll be the Sunday through Wednesday, and Monday through Wednesday will be at 7 o'clock in the evenings. So I encourage you to mark that on your calendar and do everything you can to be here for that revival meeting and be challenged in your spiritual life. Amen. We need that as much as we can get. And so let's see. We're going to have a church Thanksgiving dinner on Sunday, November the 21st. And the church will be providing the turkeys. And we're just asking if the families can bring some side dishes that's listed on the table in the back. There's a table with a little list of side dishes back there. If you see something that you like or would like to prepare and bring, but the church will prepare the turkeys. So unless you want to bring more turkey, I don't think anybody will complain. So, but the church will provide that, and there's side dishes if you want to look that over and choose which one you want to bring. And what's this? We're asking that if you invite people, invite them to church, not just dinner. Amen. Yeah. So, invite them to church and then they can have dinner afterwards. Amen. So, all right. And then let me just read this real quick. We've got time for it. This is a letter, missionary letter from the Nettervilles, one of the ministries that our church supports here. And he says, "Dear praying partners, it has been a very busy year already. It's hard to believe there's only 2 months left in 2021 so far. The Lord has allowed us to be in over 40 churches and traveling over 30,000 miles this year in July." He says it's like a blessing to get to travel all those miles. Some people like traveling. I don't care for it. But so they've traveled lots of miles, and they expanded the ministry to include Bible handouts. And praise the Lord, we've seen many precious souls saved. Visitors coming to church in 25 churches add the Bible handout to their ministry. God has blessed in a tremendous way. All these miles traveled have taken a toll on both our truck and our fifth wheel trailer. We recently had to spend 8,300 miles to fix the turbocharger on our truck, as well as one of the air conditioning units on the trailer. Although we budget for expected maintenance costs for both vehicles, these major repairs were unexpected. My wife and I have seen God miraculously take care of us in the past, and we know that He won't forsake us now. And with over 314,000 miles on our truck, this is the first major repair we've had to make. That's pretty good. If you'd like to help offset these costs, money marked as truck repairs can be sent to our supporting church, Faith Baptist Church. Our home church has given $1,000 towards these repairs. We greatly appreciate anything you may give. Thank you for your continued support for Miss Debbie and me. It has been our pleasure to serve with Ambassador Baptist Ministries over the last 7.5 years. Through the ups and downs, God has been faithful, and we look forward to continuing the Lord's work. Amen. So that's the letter from the Nettervilles. And if you remember them in your prayers, and we'll mention them also again with our prayer list, that the Nettervilles will be our missionary of the week that we pray for. Amen. And pray that God will help provide the funds to take care of the expensive maintenance fixes on his truck. Amen. And just one prayer request I have to mention now because his mind came to me. I might forget. Brother Kenneth Gerlitz. You know Kenneth Gerlitz? He usually sits back about where Sister Sue's sitting. But Brother Kenneth, he was sick for about a week and then just kept getting worse. He thought it was just a cold. Kept getting worse, went to the doctor and found out that he has COVID. So pray for Brother Kenneth that he'll recover quickly and that there won't be any complications. Amen. Most of us have already had it, and I'm glad it's behind us, those of us who have had it. So, but Brother Kenneth, he's now suffering from it, so be in prayer for him that he'll recover quickly with no complications. Amen. And another one we'll mention here in a little bit because his name's on the list. So we'll have some more music. Amen.
You could please stand and turn your hymnals to 229. This world is not my home. 229. This world is not my home. We're going to sing all four verses of this next song. On the first.
This world is not my home. I'm just a passing through. My treasures are laid up somewhere beyond the blue. The angels beckon me from heaven's open door. And I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Oh Lord, you know I have no friend like you. If heaven's not my home, then Lord, what will I do? The angels beckon me from heaven's open door. And I can't feel at home in this world anymore.
On the second.
They're all expecting me, and that's one thing I know. My Savior's pardoned me, and now I onward go. I know He'll take me through, though I am weak and poor. And I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Oh Lord, you know I have no friend like you. If heaven's not my home, then Lord, what will I do? The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore.
On the third,
I have a loving mother up in glory land. I don't expect to stop until I shake her hand. She's waiting now for me in heaven's open door. And I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Oh Lord, you know I have no friend like you. If heaven's not my home, then Lord, what will I do? The angels beckon me from heaven's open door. And I can't feel at home in this world anymore.
On the fourth.
Just up in glory land we'll live eternally. The saints on every hand are shouting victory. Their song of sweetest praise drift back from heaven's shore. And I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Oh Lord, you know I have no friend like you. If heaven's not my home, then Lord, what will I do? The angels beckon me from heaven's open door. And I can't feel at home in this world anymore.
Okay, you may be seated. Our last song for this evening is 213, where we will never grow old. 213, where we'll never grow old. We're going to sing all three verses. And if you just think about that song, I mean, it's a joy to know that. Knowing that we're not going to get old and decrepit and then just get all weak. Knowing that God's going to preserve us and keep us. So we're going to sing all three verses of this song, We'll Never Grow Old, on the first.
I have heard of a land on a far away strand. 'Tis a beautiful home of the soul. Built by Jesus on high, there we never shall die. 'Tis a land where we'll never grow old. Never grow old, never grow old. In a land where we'll never grow old. Never
second.
In that beautiful home where we never more roam, we shall be in the sweet bond. by and by. Happy praise to the King, through eternity see. 'Tis a land where we never shall die, never sorrows will end, all our voices will blend with the loved ones who've gone on before. Never grow old, never grow old, in a land where we'll never grow old. Never
take up an offering. So if our ushers can come forward here, prepare to take up an offering. And Mr. Sam, can you ask the Lord to bless this offering? Get your Bibles out. Open your Bibles to the book of Psalm chapter 44. Psalm chapter 44. And not last week, but the week before, we covered the first paragraph of this chapter. And this week I want to read through the whole chapter and then just explain a few things to you from it before we get into our prayer time. Amen. So let's go ahead and pray and ask God to bless the reading of His Word before we get into it here. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank You, Lord, for the opportunity to be in church tonight and be in fellowship with our brothers and sisters in Christ. Lord, I pray that You would use this fellowship to encourage and strengthen everyone who is here in our Christian faith so that we can continue to grow in our Christian faith. Lord, help us to every day be conformed into the image of Your Son, that we might become more like Christ as we continue on in our Christian life. Lord, I pray that You would bless the reading of Your Word at this time. Please open our hearts and our minds and give us understanding of the words that we read so that we can learn of You and learn of Your ways, so that we can understand Your ways and how to walk in Your ways more perfectly. Lord, please guide and direct everything that is said and done here at this time, that you will be glorified and the saints will be edified. I pray that you give me clarity of thought and clarity of speech that I might be able to make sense of the word of God here tonight. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Amen. So in Psalm chapter 44, we'll begin reading in verse number 1. We'll go through it and I'll just explain some things to you as we do so. So Psalm 44, verse number 1, the Bible says, "We have heard with our ears, O God, our fathers have told us what work thou didst in their days in the times of old, how thou didst drive out the heathen with thy hand and plantest them, how thou didst afflict the people and cast them out. For they got not the land of possession by their own sword, neither did their own arm save them, but thy right hand and thine arm and the light of thy countenance, because thou hast a favor unto them. Thou art my king, O God. Command deliverance for Jacob. Through thee will we push down our enemies. Through thy name will we tread them under that rise up against us. For I will not trust in my bow, neither shall my sword save me. But thou hast saved us from our enemies and hast put them to shame that hated us. In God we boast all the day long and praise thy name forever, Selah." Amen. And you remember we already covered this part 2 Wednesdays ago and explained some important things here about the fathers have told the children. They're saying, we know the stories of old because our fathers taught us the stories of old. And the faith that they had in you, we have in you, I'm trusting you the same. Amen. Because the fathers passed the stories on to their children and trained them in the ways of God, their children grew up and they have strong faith also in the Lord. Continuing that way. Of course, there were many in the nation of Israel who they turned away from God and served idols. You know, and though they were calling themselves the children of God because they were Jews, but still they turned away from God and they were serving idols. And then they became more wicked than the heathen nations around them in time. And that's why, of course, God allowed Syria to come down and judge the northern kingdom and take them out of the land. And then God allowed Babylon to come in and take Judah later on in time and scatter them throughout the known world. And but because they passed the stories on to their children grew up and had the same faith and knew who God was. Amen. And that was an important lesson we learned. But you can see God's blessings and provisions and his protection in the life of his people here in the beginning. But watch as he goes on now what happens and how they explain. And so verse number 9, he says, after explaining all these wonderful things that God did for them and by God's hand, by God's strength, they didn't get the land by their sword, but God gave it to them. God gave them the victories. And now verse 9, he says, "But thou hast cast off and put us to shame and goest not forth with our armies." Now, that would be a dreadful thing for me to have to go into war and God not be with me. And that would be the worst thing you can do, you know. But so they go to war and God's not with them. Verse 10, "Thou makest us to turn back from the enemy, and they which hate us spoil for themselves. Thou hast given us like sheep appointed for meat, and hast scattered us among the heathen. Thou sellest thy people for naught, and dost not increase thy wealth by their price." You sold us for nothing. You sold us for free. You just sold us out and didn't get anything out of this. And verse 13, "Thou makest us a reproach to our neighbors, a scorn and a derision to them that are round about us. Thou makest us a byword among the heathen, a shaking of the head among the people. My confusion is continually before me, and the shame of my face hath covered me. For the voice of him that reproacheth and blasphemeth by reason of the enemy and avenger. All this is come upon us, yet have we not forgotten thee, neither have we dealt falsely in thy covenant." All right, I've got to point something out here to you. It was because the nation of Israel as a whole turned against God and served idols for many years, generations, and God sent his prophets and his preachers to warn Israel to turn back to God, do right, don't do wicked, but serve God and do right. If you don't change, God will bring your enemy nations to judge you and take you out of the land. And they hated the prophets and the preachers who were preaching God's word to them and warning them. They hated them, killed some of them, cast them out, threw some in prison. They were not going to follow God anymore, yet they still called themselves Jews, the children of the living God. Y'all hear what I just said? Even so today, many people call themselves Christians, but they refuse to obey God, serve God, and do right in God's eyes. That's what was happening here in the nation of Israel. The nation of Israel as a whole rejected God and served idols, and yet called themselves the children of God. They would even go to the temple and do all the sacrifices that their forefathers did, and they did everything in the temple they were supposed to do, and God even gets... it got to the point where God tells them, take away from me the noise of thy vials, all your songs, I will not receive them. I will not hear them. The sacrifices, take them away. It says, you guys aren't doing right. And Christians do that too. They go to church. They put on the suit. They put on the dress clothes. They carry the Bible, whatever it might be. They go to church, but then the life they live the rest of the week is wicked. They're just like the world. And yet, calling themselves a child of God, I'm a member of the church there, here, there, wherever it's at. You know, and because of that, God brought in their enemy nations to take them out of the land. They were bringing a reproach to God, to the name of God, to the name of the Lord Jehovah. They brought a reproach to his name by saying, I'm a child of God, and yet living like the world, behaving like the devil, doing everything the devil says, not what God says. And God gives warning. By mercy and grace, God gives them a chance many times to change and come back, but they would not. And they got to the point where they began to attack the people God was using to warn them. And then finally God destroyed them and took them out of the land and scattered the Jews all over the earth. In all nations they were sold as slaves, the Bible says. And so then they become a derision to all people. People hate them. Everywhere they go, people just hate them. And it's been like that still today. Poland killed how many Jews before World War II was over? Germany, Russia. How many? Countless, millions and millions. You know, and so it's not something that has ended. Today, all the Muslim nations around Israel just hate Jews. Want to wipe them off the face of the earth. They want to turn the Mediterranean Sea red with their blood, and that will make them smile. You know, it's just the way it is. They've been a derision. The people, wherever they go, their friends, their neighbors, even the people around them, shake their head at them and hate them and want to get rid of them. But, you know, even so, if you live for Christ and you're going to be godly and stand for righteousness in this world, there's going to be people who will shake their head at you. They'll wag their head at you. You'll be a derision in their eyes. They'll wish they can get rid of you, destroy you, shut you up, or whatever they can do to move you on and get rid of you. And that's the way it is. You know, that's the world that we live in. And you can see here how they're explaining that God was so good and blessed them, but now their enemies have their way with them. And God's not with them anymore. But in verse number 17, he says, all this has come upon us, yet have we not forsaken thee, neither have we dealt falsely in thy covenant. Our heart is not turned back, neither have our steps declined from thy way. There's always been a remnant who loved God and did right. Amen. There was people in Israel still, not all of Israel hated God and turned away from God and turned to idols. There was always a remnant who loved God, did not turn away from God, did not turn to idols, just always loved the Lord and did right because they knew who God was. And they loved him. He knew that he was theirs and he was his, or how would I say it? That they were his and he was theirs. Amen. Like today, we are in Christ. Christ is in us. We are in God. Amen. We're all one with the Lord. And so these are now people talking here that we have not gone astray. We have not done wrong. We always look to you. We always love you. We've always served you. And verse number 18, our back, neither have our steps declined from thy way. Though thou hast sore broken us in the place of dragons and covered us with the shadow of death, if we have forgotten the name of our God or stretched out our hands to a strange God, shall not God search this out? For he knoweth the secrets of the heart. yea, for thy sake. Verse number 22, yea, for thy sake are we killed all the day long. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter. Does that sound familiar? You guys ever read the book of Romans chapter 8? That exact verse is quoted in Romans 8. We're going to turn there in a moment to explain more so you can understand what he's saying here. But verse number 23, he says, awake, why sleepest thou, O Lord? Arise, cast us not off forever. Wherefore hidest thou thy face and forgettest our affliction and our oppression? For our soul is bowed down to the dust, our belly cleaveth unto the earth. Arise for our help and redeem us for thy mercy's sake. Amen. So now verses 9 through 16, because they turn away from God, God sells them into slavery, and they're a byword amongst all the nations. Verses 17 through 25, the righteous lay out their complaint to God for all their sufferings that they face as they live in a sin-sick world. Amen. There's always going to be people who love the Lord. God said he'll always have a remnant. That remnant has to suffer. They have to suffer with the rest of the sin-sick world. Because diseases come, sicknesses come, wars come, fightings come. Now, all these things come, and the righteous are, because we live in a sin-sick world, we have to suffer things that this world brings upon itself, living in this world. Y'all understand? Some people, it's funny in Fiji, if you get sick, if you get sick, I might have compassion and say, God's just trying to refine you, and God's working your life, and God's trying to teach you something here. But if I get sick, I say, God's judging me for my sin. What is it, Lord? I'm trying to confess anything I can think up. You know, we don't know every time why we suffer, why we get sick. I mean to say why we get sick. But I do know that we all suffer because this world is a sin-sick world. And living in this world, we're going to suffer the things that this world has to suffer because we live in it. Amen? And as children of God, not only do we have to suffer within this sin-sick world and suffer all the things that go along because of sin in the world, we're going to have enemies who hate us. But it's not us they hate. It's God that they hate. If you're going to stand for God, stand for truth, stand for the righteousness of God, the world's going to hate you. And they're going to try and make you denounce Christ. They're going to try and separate you from the love of God. They'll try and kill you off, get rid of you. But they'll target your faith. They'll try and cast your faith. They'll try and separate you from the love of God by any way that they possibly can. And yet, as a child of God, being convinced of the Lord, you allow yourself to suffer horrible things in this life for his name's sake. How many Christians have suffered throughout the ages? Multitudes. Amen? Because of their professed faith in Jesus Christ. For the Lord's sake, many of his saints have suffered in this sin-sick world and suffered persecutions when people are trying to separate them from the love of God. Denounce Christ and we'll let you go free. Denounce your religion. We'll let your child live. We won't kill him in front of your eyes. Denounce Christ and we'll let him live. We won't hurt him. Now, all kinds of wicked things that they've done through time. For the Lord's sake, many saints have suffered great things. Verse 22, yea, for thy sake are we killed all the day long. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter. And look over in Romans chapter 8, verse 33. Romans chapter 8. And as you turn your Bibles to Romans chapter 8, I just want to mention again the last verse in Psalm 44, verse 26. He says, arise for our help and redeem us for thy mercy's sake. You know, God will redeem anyone who comes to him with a humble heart and asks for redemption. Amen? Right. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Amen. God will redeem anyone who comes to him humbly and seeks that forgiveness and that redemption. Amen. And now Romans, Romans chapter 8, verse 33. I'm just going to read through this as a closing. In Romans chapter 8, verse 33, we'll read verses 33 down to 39. He says, who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? It is God that justifieth. Who is he that condemneth? It is Christ that died, yea, rather, is risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who also maketh intercession for us. Amen. Where is Jesus Christ? At the right hand of the throne of God. The throne of God is the place of judgment. Jesus sits at the right hand of the throne of God. Why is Jesus at the right hand of the throne of God? Making intercession for us. You know what that shows me? God's people need intercession from time to time. We need an interceder. We need someone who, an advocate. We need an advocate with the Father. Somebody who will plead our cause because we fail, we make mistakes, we break the law. The laws of God. You understand? So as a child of God, those who are redeemed, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous, the Bible says in the book of 1 John. When Jesus sits at the right hand of the throne of God making intercession for us. When we make a mistake and do something wrong, the wrath of God should fall upon us because God is just. Amen? And He will deal with lawbreakers. When the wrath of God should fall upon us, Jesus Christ is there interceding for us, saying, oh wait, that one's mine. He's put His faith in my blood. He's forgiven. Making intercession for us. Y'all understand? So who can separate us from the love of God? If we have an intercessor, Jesus Christ the righteous, sitting at the right hand of the throne of God, interceding for us, who can separate us from the love of God? Can you separate yourself from the love of God? Once you're in Christ, He will intercede for you forever. You're His forever and ever. Amen. Amen? So, who is he that condemneth? It is Christ that died, yea, rather that is risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who also maketh intercession for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecutions, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? These are all things we just read about in the book of Psalm chapter 44. All these things they're suffering in this world because of sin. And things that are going on, and even because of their stand for righteousness, being persecuted and being hated. For His sake, they suffer. For His sake, they were counted as sheep for the slaughter. And it's the same still today. There's nothing that can separate us from the love of God, nor peril, nor sword, verse 36. As it is written, for thy sake, we are killed all the day long. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through Him that loved us. Amen. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. You know, we do live in a sin-sick world. We have to suffer with this world because we live in this world. Amen. And for the Lord's sake, as a child of God, if we stand for righteousness, for His sake, we're going to be persecuted. Some will be killed. We're counted as sheep for the slaughter. You know? But still, nothing can separate us from the love of God. Amen? Amen? And we know our end. We know their end. Amen? Just like lost people suffer in the world. We suffer in the world because we live in this world. Even if we have to suffer persecution for His name's sake. This life is short. We know our end and we know their end. Their end is eternal damnation for all eternity, separated from God. But our end is to be with the Lord. Is to be present with the Lord. No more sickness, no more pain, no more suffering. No more dealing with trouble in a sin-sick world that the world has to deal with. We're delivered from all that. Yeah. For us, death is deliverance. Death is not a bad thing. Death is to be present with the Lord. Amen? To be delivered from all this trouble. So when my friend Nava Savu passed away there in Fiji, I was a bit jealous. In the beginning, I didn't like that he had to go, but I felt like, man, he's lucky. He's done with this world. He's done with the temptations, the struggles, the trials, the sicknesses, and he's up there enjoying now. You know, it's not fair. Why don't we get to go first? You know, but that's our end. Our end is really no end. It's a beginning of a great life. Amen. And so nobody can separate us from the love of God. No matter what people try, those who are truly born again, the Spirit of God's inside. When persecution arises, hear me out, when persecution arises, the Holy Ghost enables you, gives you grace to endure it, to accept it, even often to rejoice in the persecutions. Have you not read the New Testament? They're stoned. They were beaten and whipped. And they come out rejoicing that they were able to suffer such things for the gospel of Jesus Christ. They didn't mind at all. Laughing and rejoicing and having a good time with a bunch of stripes, maybe blood on their back. I don't know what kind of things they, I don't know how those whippings turned out. I don't think it'd be good. Those Romans were cruel people. But, you know, when you're in Christ, the Holy Ghost is with you, God enables you. God's grace is there to sustain you and enable you to accept whatever, you know. We do get frustrated at times. You know, I don't like to suffer pains at all. Sometimes I think, Lord, just take us home. You know, hey, why do I have to suffer this? Just take us home. You know, as John the Revelator says, even so, Lord Jesus, come quickly. You know, even so, Lord, you know, come quickly, Lord. But until then, we just live for Him, do our best. Nothing can separate us from the love of God. Amen. And in Christ, you're in a better position. Amen. The world suffers because we live in the world. We'll suffer with it. But our end is good. Their end is bad. Amen. So, you know, rejoice in these things. Take hope. Take courage. Amen. In the Lord, and in spite of fears and troubles, just take courage and live and enjoy and look up to heaven and smile at God in hard times, because God's there to come through for us. Amen. Nobody can separate us from the love of God. Amen. With everybody's heads bowed, everybody's eyes closed, we just want to invite you to pray and talk to the Lord. If you want to come to the altar as the musician come and play a song here, if you want to come to the altar and pray and give God thanks for who He is and for what He's done in your life, or if you want to just kneel down or even sit at your seat and pray, I just want to encourage you to use this time and pray and talk to the Lord. Maybe you're here today, you've been suffering persecution from neighbors or coworkers or classmates at school, I don't know. Maybe you're just tired of physical pains. You know, talk to the Lord about these things. God cares. Amen. He is your God. He's your Father. He's very merciful.
There is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's vein, and sinners plunge all their guilty stains, loose all their guilty stains, loose all their guilty stains, and sinners plunge beneath that flood, loose all their guilty.
Today, and you're not sure that you're a child of God. You're not sure that you're a Christian. Maybe you've called yourself a Christian for many years, or you've gone to church for many years, but you, deep down inside, you don't have peace with God about going to heaven. You're not 100% sure that you'll wake up in heaven when you die. If there's anybody here like that, if you'll just raise your hand, let me see your hand. I want to pray for you. By raising your hand, you're saying, preacher, I'm not sure I'm a child of God. I've been a Christian my whole life, but I'm not sure that I'm born again. I'm not sure I'm going to heaven when I die. Will you please pray for me? Anybody like that? Is everybody's heads bowed, everybody's eyes are closed, they're praying? Anybody like that? Preacher, I'm just not sure I'm going to heaven. If I die today, I might end up in hell. I don't know. Will you please pray for me? Anybody like that? There can be nothing more important in life than for you to know that you're going to heaven when you die. The Bible is very clear that we can know for sure that we have eternal life. Amen. And if you don't know for sure, I really challenge you. You better find out that you know for sure. Find out how to know for sure. Amen. Because if you don't know for sure, there's a good chance you're not going to heaven according to the scriptures. Make sure you know that you have eternal life. Amen. We'll have another song here.
The dying thief rejoiced to see that fountain in his day. And then
time, we'll go ahead and take up some extra prayer requests. We'll take a couple minutes here. We have time for it. Y'all have your prayer list. If you need a prayer list, will you raise up your hand, and one of the ushers will make sure and get you one of those prayer lists. And I just want to mention a couple.